McGraw-Hill Ascent Audio presents All About Asset Allocation, Second Edition, by Richard A. Ferri, narrated by Bob Johnson. Publisher's Note: In this audio edition, you will hear references to figures and tables present in the print and ebook formats of the book. Foreword. In the fall of 1929, Alfred Coles III had an ordinary, if rather large, problem. Ordinary because, like many other Americans, he had been badly hurt by the recent stock market crash, and large because not only was he the heir to the Chicago Tribune fortune, but he also managed it. A highly intelligent young man, he took his charge seriously, consuming as much written analysis from the nation's brokerage houses, insurance firms, and financial commentators as he could. Alas, it was in vain. None of them warned him of the impending crash. How could the country's brightest financial stars have been so uniformly wrong? Coles's response to the catastrophic stock market decline that wiped out nearly 90% of the stock market's value over the next 3 years and the Great Depression that it ignited has thundered down through the financial markets to this very day. Modern investors ignore the lessons learned by Coles and those who followed in his footsteps, at their own peril. For what Coles and his followers did was nothing less than remove finance from the realm of ignorance and superstition and place it on a scientific footing. With the help of the nation's foremost economists, he founded the Econometric Society and, along with the legendary Benjamin Graham, who had been similarly affected by the 1929 crash, he began to collect and analyze financial data in the most detailed and thoroughgoing way possible. In effect, he and those who have followed him in the 7 decades since took investing away from the astrologers and the charlatans and gave it to the astronomers and physicists. This is, in some cases, quite literally true. Many of the finest minds of modern finance began their careers in the physical sciences. Unfortunately, when you pick up a financial magazine, watch CNBC, or call your broker, you've just traveled back to the pre-1929 era. In fact, you've just accomplished the financial equivalent of betting the farm on the daily horoscope or of taking a rare cancer to a doctor whose main source of recent medical knowledge is USA Today. Like most intellectual revolutions, the modern science of investing is highly counterintuitive. Do you think that it is possible, through careful securities research, to reliably select market-beating portfolios? Wrong. The data show that, although many investors do so, in almost all cases, this is purely the result of the randomness of the markets. In simple terms, dumb luck. People have also gotten fabulously rich buying lottery tickets. They have also gotten off scot-free without ever wearing a seatbelt. That does not make either activity a good idea. Do you think that by choosing a portfolio of only a few stocks that you hope will score big, you are maximizing your chances of becoming wealthy? Indeed, you are. But by doing so, you are also maximizing your chances of a retirement of cat food cuisine. And make no mistake about it, the object of this particular game is not to get rich, it's to not get poor. All About Asset Allocation will bring you back into the modern era with a comprehensive yet understandable exposition of how to apply to your investment portfolio what 7 decades of financial research have taught us about investing. Building an asset allocation is much like putting up a skyscraper. You will need blueprints, what asset classes to buy, which ones to skip, and how much of each to use. You will also need the construction materials, which building blocks to buy, and whom to buy them from. Rick Ferri provides you with both of these, in spades. Unfortunately, in building your financial skyscraper, there is one thing that neither Rick nor I nor any other financial expert can do for you, which is to provide you with the nerve to stick to those blueprints when you find yourself 30 stories up in the naked girders in a howling wind. But with All About Asset Allocation by your side, you'll know that you're executing a sound design, using the best materials, and wearing the best safety rope that money can buy. William Bernstein. Introduction. Is asset allocation dead? Has the past decade changed the way I should invest? Can I trust the markets to meet my financial needs? The short answers are no, perhaps, and yes. The first decade in the new millennium was a challenge for all investors. Unprecedented shocks caused extremes in market volatility over the period. The decade began with the deflation of technology and communication stock expectations, followed by two attacks on U.S. soil that led to two wars fought halfway around the world, and finished with a housing price collapse that brought too-big-to-fail global financial institutions to their knees and massive government bailouts. The events of the past decade have shaken the foundations of investment knowledge and have forced people to rethink their own investment strategies from the ground up. People are questioning the validity of modern portfolio theory, MPT, that had become well indoctrinated into portfolios. Do the markets still operate efficiently? Is a buy-and-hold investment strategy dead? How does a radical shift in the global economic power affect my portfolio? Is the U.S. dollar in a long-term decline? What new asset classes are available, and should I invest in them? These questions are all valid, and they all deserve answers. In your quest for information and solutions, you will find no shortage of people willing to help with answers, any answers, even bad answers, and there will be people trying to sell you products that go along with their answers. If it isn't one person pushing you into gold or commodity investments, it's another saying you should invest in the Chinese real estate market. Everyone selling a product has an answer to volatility in the first decade, and most are selling products that you'd best avoid. Deep down, I believe that everyone knows that the future is unknowable, which means that you cannot pick one sector or one investment and count on it for financial security. But this does not stop us from wishing we did know, and this is why people pay good money for the advice of experts. But which expert do you believe? Which one are you going to rely on for advice? Block out gurus who say that they can tell the next move in the stock markets, interest rates, or the price of gold because they don't know. Focus instead on those advisors who recommend developing a long-term investment policy using a diversified asset base and then implementing that policy with diligence, dedication, and discipline. It's all about asset allocation. The investment strategies outlined in this second edition of All About Asset Allocation provide a no-nonsense, business-like approach to getting a tough job done. They offer an investment solution that is easy to understand, rational in its approach, and just plain workable. Simply stated, spread your investment risk across many different securities while keeping costs very low and controlling for risk and taxes. Don't try to outguess the markets because you will not be successful in the long term, and it will cost you dearly. Control what you can control: costs, taxes, risk. Then let the markets take care of the rest. This approach has the highest probability of financial success. What asset allocation can and cannot do. A prudent asset allocation that is followed by discipline will increase your chances for reaching and maintaining financial security over your lifetime. That being said, no investment strategy can protect your portfolio all the time. You must be prepared for some bumps in the road. There will be poor months, quarters, and occasionally years. There is no getting around this fact. Unfortunately, there is also a large market for financial fraud. Many unethical and unscrupulous investment experts will say that they have found a risk-free road to wealth. They are lying. High returns do not come without risk. Many experts who said that they had the secret to success in the markets went to jail in 2008 and 2009. Bernard Madoff was the most famous person, followed by many other less famous crooks. There is no free lunch on Wall Street. There is risk. This risk can be controlled to some extent through good investment policy and prudent execution of that policy. Disciplined investors who follow their well-defined investment policy will come out far ahead of those who drift aimlessly from strategy to strategy, hoping for a lucky break. The lessons in this book are simple. First, allocate your investments across multiple asset classes to reduce overall portfolio risk. Second, invest broadly within each asset class to eliminate the specific risk of owning any single security. Third, keep your costs as low as feasible, including taxes. Fourth, rebalance your portfolio periodically to keep your risk on target with your investment policy. Asset allocation is a simple concept to understand and yet extremely difficult to implement. You can select asset classes easily, decide on the percentage target for each asset class, choose low-cost mutual funds to represent the asset classes, and perhaps intend to get your portfolio on track. Yet, despite good intentions, many people have great difficulty implementing their strategy fully or maintaining it after the initial allocation. There are too many distractions. You don't have the time. The market doesn't look right. The talking heads are saying something else, and so on. To top it all off, a friend or family member was just hired by a brokerage firm, and you promised to listen to his or her novice sales ideas. Procrastination has killed good intentions. Rebalancing is often the most difficult part of an asset allocation strategy because it is counterintuitive. Rebalancing requires you to sell a little of the investment that went up and buy more of what went down. Can you imagine buying stocks in early 2009 when the market was more than 60% below its high and every expert on television was predicting lower prices? That is exactly what the strategy required, and the only investors who were rewarded with excess returns by the end of 2009 were those who rebalanced religiously. The temptations to deviate from a simple investment strategy are great. I know from my years of experience that many people are not able to stay the course. There is a solution. If you do not have the discipline to manage an asset allocation strategy yourself, then hire a competent, low-fee advisor to do it. You will pay for this service, but at least the job gets done fully and efficiently. The concept of total risk. Do you know how much portfolio risk you can handle? I will tell you that it is not all about market risk. There is a lot going on in your life besides your investments. What happens outside your portfolio can affect how you react to your portfolio. For example, if the markets are down, typically the economy is slow or slowing, which means that consumer confidence is low and perhaps your job is at risk. These outside influences create stresses in your life that may affect the way you invest your well-thought-out strategy. Your asset allocation should take into account potential stressors that may not seem to have direct impact on the asset allocation process. I spoke with one person in late 2009 who said she sold stocks at the bottom of the bear market. Now, she wanted to go back in at the same 60% stock allocation. My reaction was that she was investing above her tolerance for risk in 2009, and that going back in at a 60% in stock was a mistake. It was my opinion that she would only make the same knee-jerk emotional mistake again during the next bear market. She insisted that she would not, because last time she had just been through a messy divorce, her mother took ill, and she had to move in to help, and her dog died. The loss of a job or any other loss can cause investors to abandon their investment policy, even if the portfolio was set to the right risk level for the investors based only on their future financial needs. A change in health can make people feel as though they have less control over their life, and this may cause them to overcompensate in an area they can control, such as changing their investment portfolio. One does not often think about job security, family matters, family health, and the amount of debt you owe as factors in an asset allocation decision, but they are very important. Making an emotional decision to change your portfolio when other factors are stressing you typically does not lead to a better outcome. Ignoring outside risk factors when setting a portfolio asset allocation strategy can lead to too much life risk, and that can produce behavioral mistakes down the road. In this second edition of All About Asset Allocation, I have enhanced the behavioral finance section. There is also a new chapter on when to change an allocation and how to do it. These new tools assist investors with implementing and maintaining their investment policy so it can roll with life's punches. The fundamental concepts written in this book provide a blueprint for the design, implementation, and maintenance of a prudent, reliable, lifelong investment plan. In some cases, the plan goes beyond the grave. Read it, study it, create a plan, implement it, and maintain it. You will not be disappointed. Advice from experience. There is an old saying that if you really want to get to know people, you should either marry them or manage their money. I have been married to the same wonderful woman for most of my adult life, and I have also had the fortunate experience of getting to know many people over the decades by personally managing their investment portfolios. As a professional, it has been my job to understand people's personal, financial, and family situations so that I can best advise them on investment decisions. This means asking about personal and some non-financial issues that may affect their outlook in the future. It is only with this understanding that my company can help guide an investor toward a prudent asset allocation. This process is by no means static. It is an ongoing challenge. What I have learned over the years is that every investor has unique issues, and then we all have issues that are very similar. We all have liabilities that need to be paid for in the future, and we want to ensure there is enough money to meet those needs. We are concerned about health care, taxes, educating our children and grandchildren, and then helping them later in life if needed. Most important, we do not want to outlive our own money and become a burden to our families. That is the biggest fear most people have about money. What differs about how we view money is the amount we each need to cover future liabilities. In other words, we differ in lifestyle. Different careers and opportunities lead us to different standards of living. What may be comfortable for one person may not be good enough for another. Matching current assets and future income streams to those different liabilities is a challenge. This is where reasonable expectations, financial planning, and proper investment policy come in. Investment policy. Investment policy is a statement about how you will implement and maintain your investment portfolio. It is typically a simple and concise document that is easy for you to understand and follow. Some people write a policy for themselves, and other people go to a professional. The advisor may do a complete financial plan in an effort to find the investment policy that best fits your needs. Everyone has different financial needs, different investment experiences, and different perceptions of risk. These differences make designing portfolios a multifaceted and challenging exercise. Accordingly, the information in this book cannot cover every scenario, and the asset allocation examples in this book should be viewed as examples, not recommendations. There is no one-size-fits-all solution, especially when people are approaching their pre-retirement age. it will be up to you to grasp the important concepts that drive a successful asset allocation and then develop a portfolio mix to meet your special needs and circumstances. Over your lifetime, how you divide your investments among stocks, bonds, real estate, and other asset classes will explain almost all your portfolio risk and return, providing you have the discipline to maintain your plan. This makes the asset allocation decision one of the most important decisions in your life and is worth spending considerable time understanding. At its root, asset allocation is a simple idea. Diversify a portfolio across several unlike investments to reduce the risk of a large loss. Controlling risk through a prudent asset allocation plan and proper portfolio maintenance keeps you focused on the big picture during difficult periods in the market cycle, and this discipline is the key to your long-term investment success. Different asset allocation strategies. There are three different types of asset allocation strategies. One is a long-term strategy that is the focus of the book. It does not require making short-term predictions about the markets in order to be successful. The other two require short-term market prediction in order to be successful. I leave those to the television talking heads. 1. Strategic asset allocation. No predictions needed. 2. Tactical and dynamic asset allocation. Requires accurate market predictions. 3. Market timing. Requires accurate market predictions. This book is all about long-term strategic asset allocation. This strategy is commonly known as buy and hold. However, I believe it is best described as buy, hold, and rebalance. Strategic asset allocation focuses on selecting suitable asset classes and investments to be held for the long run. An asset allocation should not change based on the cyclical ups and downs of the economy or because some cynic publicly doubts the strategy and then personally benefits from investors who waver. Once this allocation is set, it does need occasional review and perhaps tweaking, especially when there are changes in a person's life. Tactical asset allocation is not the topic of this book, and this is the only place I address it. Tactical asset allocation assumes active changes to an investment mix based on short-term market forecasts for returns. These predictions may be a function of fundamental variables such as earnings or interest rate forecasts, economic variables such as the outlook for economic growth in different countries, or technical variables such as recent price trends and charting patterns. Market timing is tactical asset allocation in the extreme. It is an all-in or all-out decision on asset classes. For example, a market timer may start the year 100% in stocks, change to 50% stocks and 50% in bonds sometime during the year, and end with 100% in cash. Market timing is for people who believe they can consistently forecast major movements in the market and thus beat the market by trading. Tactical asset allocation and market timing sound like wonderful ideas, and they sure make a good sales pitch. However, just about every unbiased academic study ever conducted shows that this type of asset allocation advice is no better than flipping a coin. The advocates spin a good tale about how they can weave in and out of the markets, but they don't consistently make money doing it. The only reliable asset allocation strategy is the one discussed in this book. A well-balanced, multi-asset class portfolio that is maintained over time has the highest probability of success. All About Asset Allocation focuses on selecting the right asset class mix for your needs, choosing low-cost investments that represent those asset classes, implementing the strategy, and maintaining it. The facts and figures are presented in as straightforward a manner as possible. Some of the data are technical, so I've tried to illustrate these concepts with figures and explain their meaning in easy-to-understand terms. When you have finished listening to all the chapters and you understand the important concepts in each chapter, you will possess the knowledge and the tools you will need to put together a sensible portfolio allocation that will serve you well for many years ahead. A review of the chapters. All About Asset Allocation is divided into three parts. All three are equally important. Accordingly, the best way to listen to this book is to go all the way through. Part 1 explains the need for investment policy and the basic theory behind an asset allocation strategy. Chapter 1 explains why creating a viable investment plan is critical to success and how asset allocation works in the plan. Chapter 2 is all about investment risk. Risk is defined in many different ways by many different people, ranging from losing money to the volatility of portfolio returns. Chapter 3 covers the technical aspects of asset allocation based on a two-asset class portfolio. It covers basic formulas and historical market relationships. Chapter 4 expands into multi-asset class investing. Adding more asset classes to a portfolio can reduce risk and increase long-term return. Part 2 is the discovery of investment opportunities. Chapter 5 discusses the methodology used to segregate asset class types and styles. Chapter 6 looks at the U.S. equity market and its various components. Chapter 7 looks at international markets and how diversifying overseas helps U.S. investors. Chapter 8 is an examination of the U.S. fixed income market and its various components. Chapter 9 covers real estate investing, including home ownership. Chapter 10 is an explanation of alternative asset classes, including commodities, hedge funds, precious metals, and collectibles. All chapters provide a sample list of appropriate mutual funds and ETFs. By the time you have finished listening to Part 2, you will have a comprehensive list of potential investments to consider. Part 3 is about managing your investment portfolio. Chapter 11 focuses on methods used to forecast various market risks and returns, along with a list of this author's estimates. Chapter 12 covers a life cycle concept of investing and provides several examples of potential portfolios. Chapter 13 is an interesting chapter on behavioral finance. The right asset allocation is the one that matches both your needs and your personality. Chapter 14 is new to this edition. It covers when it is appropriate to change your asset allocation and how to do it. Chapter 15 finishes up with a discussion of fees, taxes, index funds, and the pros and cons of hiring professional management. The appendixes offer a wealth of extended information on asset allocation books and helpful investment websites. Part 1. Asset Allocation Basics. Chapter 1. Planning for Investment Success. Key Concepts. Investment planning is critical to long-term success. Asset allocation is the key element of investment planning. Discipline and commitment to a strategy are needed. There are no shortcuts to achieving financial security. A successful lifelong investment experience hinges on three critical steps: the development of a prudent investment plan, the full implementation of that plan, and the discipline to maintain the plan in good times and bad. If you create a good plan and follow it, your probability of financial freedom increases exponentially. An investment plan provides the roadmap to fair and equitable investment results over the long term. Your asset allocation decision is the most important step in investment planning. This is the amount of money you commit to each of the various asset classes, such as stocks, bonds, real estate, and cash. It is your asset allocation that largely determines the growth path of your money and level of portfolio risk in the long run. Exactly how you invest in each of these asset classes is of lesser importance than owning the asset classes themselves, although some ways are better and less expensive than others. What is your current investment policy? Consider the following two portfolio management strategies. Which one best describes you today? Plan A. Buy investments that I expect will perform well over the next few years. If an investment performs poorly or the prospects change, switch to another investment or go to cash and wait for a better opportunity. Plan B. Buy and hold different types of investments in a diversified portfolio, regardless of their near-term prospects. If an investment performs poorly, buy more of that investment to put my portfolio back in balance. If you are like most investors, Plan A looks familiar. People tend to put their money into investments that they believe will lead to profitable results in the near term and sell those that do not perform. The goal of Plan A is to do well, which is not a quantifiable financial goal. What does do well mean? Plan A provides no guidelines for what to buy or when to buy it and when to sell because of poor performance or changing prospects. Academic research shows that people who trade their accounts based on near-term performance tend to sell investments that eventually perform better than the new investment they buy. I have talked with thousands of individual investors about their portfolios over the years. It is interesting to ask people what their investment plan has been and if their returns have met their expectations. Most people will say that they have some type of investment plan, and they will say that their performance is generally in line with the markets. But both these statements are wishful thinking. An analysis of their portfolio often shows little evidence that any plan actually exists or has ever existed, and that their investment performance tends to be several percentage points below what they guessed it might have been. The sad truth is that a majority of investors choose their stocks, bonds, and mutual funds randomly, with little consideration for how they all fit together or the amount they pay in fees, commissions, and other expenses. Characteristics of a plan. Successful investing is a three-step process. 1. Plan creation. 2. Implementation. And 3. Maintenance. It is an important step forward for people to recognize that they need a good investment plan and good investments in the plan to meet their long-term financial objectives. Once people come to that realization, they need a method for creating their plan, which is where this book comes in. 2, they need to implement the plan, because a good plan not implemented is no plan at all. Finally, and most important, is a process for maintaining the plan, because discipline drives long-term results. A good plan has long legs and should last several years without major modifications. Annual reviews and adjustments are appropriate, with major changes occurring when something has changed in your life. Adjustments to plans should never be made in reaction to poor market conditions or be based on a comment some talking head made on television. You would not quit your job and change occupations because you are going through a slump, nor should you change your investment plan because your portfolio is suffering in a bear market. These off periods are natural and expected, and you must learn to live with them. Put your investment plan in writing, because a written plan is not soon forgotten. Your investment policy statement, IPS, should include your financial needs, investment goals, asset allocation, description of investment choices, and why you believe this plan should get you to your goals over time. I guarantee that you will not be making many snap investment decisions if you have the discipline to read your IPS before you make any change. All the planning in the world will not help if a plan is not implemented and religiously maintained. Most investment plans never become fully implemented because of a host of excuses, including procrastination, distractions, laziness, lack of commitment, and the never-ending search for a perfect plan. I estimate that less than 50% of investment plans written are actually fully put into place, but that is not the whole story. Regular maintenance is the key to success following plan implementation. Markets are dynamic, and so is your portfolio. Periodic maintenance is needed to ensure that a portfolio is kept in line with the plan. It is likely that less than 10% of all investment plans are fully implemented and maintained long enough and with enough discipline to make them work efficiently. Perhaps you may think I am being pessimistic, but that is what I have witnessed in my many years in the investment business. Many great investment plans fall by the wayside each year. There are a lot of good intentions out there, but there is much more procrastination. There are no shortcuts. Money and life are intertwined in our culture. Our financial well-being is always on our minds. Will we have enough money? Will our children have enough for college? Is my income secure? What will happen to Social Security? Will I be able to afford health care? Are taxes going up? Will I be able to sell my house at the price I want when that time comes? Will I have to borrow money? What is my credit score? Most working people struggle to cover their living expenses, let alone save enough for future obligations, including retirement. They question when or whether they will be able to retire, and, if they do retire, whether they will have a lifestyle that makes them comfortable. In the final years of life, decisions must be made about who gets our unspent money, how they get the money, and who is going to execute our estate. Money management is a never-ending battle from the time we get our first paycheck until we end our stay on this great planet. Money matters are stressful, and investment decisions are part of that stress. When we save a little money, we don't want to lose it by investing poorly. Yet, we do want a respectable rate of return. The earlier in life a person learns to invest money, the better off that person will be both financially and emotionally. Unfortunately, proper investing principles are not taught to the general public. There are no required courses on investing in high schools or trade schools, or as part of a required curriculum at colleges, law schools, or medical schools. In addition, employers do not require employees to educate themselves about investing their 401k or other retirement accounts. The government does not get between investors and their money unless there is fraud or misrepresentation involved. The public is all alone on financial education, and, unfortunately, that typically results in an expensive trial-and-error process. Learning about investing through trial and error takes years of disappointments before you are able to discern good information from bad. It is very common for people to slip far behind the market averages during this learning period, and most people never make up the losses. When people realize that they have made investment mistakes and have fallen behind, they tend to compensate by becoming either overly conservative or overly aggressive. Both are bad. Once burnt, twice shy investors may not reach their financial goal if they do not formulate a plan that is aggressive enough to get there. Other people may become more aggressive in an attempt to get their money back quickly. The newspapers regularly print stories of people who decided to swing for the fences only to end up losing much more or being swindled by an unscrupulous advisor. When young people make investing mistakes, they are not too damaging because these people typically have little in the pot and they have years of work and savings ahead. However, when an older person makes the same mistake, it can be devastating. The papers are full of sad stories about retirees' life savings being wiped out because they put all their eggs in one basket and lost, or perhaps they were taken by the likes of a Bernie Madoff. Enron Corporation was a highly publicized corporate bankruptcy that resulted from accounting fraud that ruined the financial lives of many people nearing retirement age. You could not pick up a newspaper or popular magazine without seeing an article about a former Enron employee who lost nearly all of his or her savings as a result of the company's collapse. Some former Enron workers considered selling their homes just to pay bills. Others were so devastated by the event that they did not know what would become of them. The stories typically included photographs of the victims depicted in a state of despair. Did the people in this country learn from Enron? No. Over the next decade, thousands of bankruptcies and near bankruptcies claimed the retirement savings of hundreds of thousands of rank-and-file employees who believed in those companies by purchasing their bonds. Some of those companies are household names, including General Motors, Lehman Brothers, AIG, Bear Stearns, and Chrysler. Will these bankruptcies of too-big-to-fail companies teach others to diversify their investments and lower their portfolio risk using asset allocation? Not likely. Why professional advice does not always help. How do you learn about investing and, at the same time, avoid costly mistakes? One way is to hire a professional investment consultant, if you are lucky enough to find a good one. Hiring an advisor is a hit-or-miss proposition. The range of experience and education in the investment advisor industry is very broad. There are many professionals who are committed to their profession and would be very helpful in setting up an investment plan. And then there are those, regrettably, who would do more harm than good. The investment business pays an abnormally high salary. Earnings for the typical advisor are on par with a well-paid physician or attorney. However, unlike physicians and attorneys who are required to have years of education before seeing patients and clients, investment consultants hired by a large brokerage house can start managing clients' money within a few months of deciding to get into the industry, and they can earn significant income in a couple of years if they are good salespeople. The requirements for becoming a registered representative at a brokerage firm or an independent, fee-only advisor are surprisingly low. You don't need to have a degree in finance or any formal education. All you need to do is be able to read and write English, be felony-free, and pass a simple exam. It takes about as much time and effort to become registered as a broker or advisor as it does for a 16-year-old to get a driver's license. With one exception, the 16-year-old must show competence when driving before getting to the license. Since the barrier of entry into the investment field is so low, it should not be surprising when the Wall Street Journal publishes a long list of brokers and advisors each week who have been disciplined by the regulatory authorities for gross negligence, misappropriation of client funds, and outright fraud. I do not want to be too critical of the brokers and advisors in the investment industry because there are many outstanding people out there. The problem you have is separating the good from the bad. There is no easy shortcut to doing this. Even those with the best credentials have fallen, and it takes only one bad decision by an investment advisor to wipe out your entire life savings. Bernie Madoff's former clients know that too well. The assets in asset allocation. At its core, asset allocation is about dividing your wealth into different places to reduce the risk of a large loss. 100 years ago, that may have meant burying some cash in mason jars around the barn, in addition to hiding money in your mattress in the cookie jar. If your house went up in flames, at least the buried mason jar money would survive. I am not advocating putting money in a mattress or in mason jars as an asset allocation strategy. This book focuses on placing money in publicly available investments such as mutual funds and exchange-traded funds, ETFs, and how that fits in with other assets such as your home, other real estate, businesses, hard assets such as coins and art, restricted corporate stock and stock options, and any claim you have on employer pensions, Social Security, and annuity income. Figure 1-1, located in the print version of this book, is an investment pyramid that divides investment into five parts. The pyramid is used to classify assets and illustrate differences in liquidity and discretion that you may or may not have with those assets. Here are brief descriptions of the five levels. 1. Level 1 is the base of the pyramid. It is characterized by highly liquid cash and cash types of investments that are used for living expenses and emergencies. This money is typically in checking accounts, savings accounts, and money market funds. This cash is not part of your long-term investment allocation, and you should not be overly concerned that your rate of return is low. The amount to keep in cash varies with your circumstances. I recommend 3 to 4 months in cash if you are single, 6 to 12 months in cash if you have a family, and 24 months when you retire. 2. Level 2 covers liquid long-term investments. These are discretionary investments, meaning that you choose how to invest this money. The choices for investments typically include mutual funds, exchange-traded funds, certificates of deposit, and bonds. The accounts that hold these investments typically include self-directed retirement accounts, employee savings accounts, personal savings accounts, and fixed and variable annuities that are still accumulating, that is, have not been annuitized. These assets can typically be converted into cash within 1 week. 3. Level 3 covers less liquid long-term investments that are also discretionary. They include your home and other real properties, businesses, art and other collectibles, hedge funds, venture capital funds, and other limited partnerships. These investments are less liquid than Level 2 securities. They may be converted to cash over time, but it could take weeks, months, or even years. 4. Level 4 tends to cover investments that you have little or no discretion over. These assets can include employer-restricted corporate stock and stock options, employer-managed pension plans, Social Security benefits, and annuities that are paying out. These assets have strict rules governing what the money can be invested in, who can take the money, and when. 5. Level 5 is somewhat out of sequence. It covers speculative capital. These are the trading accounts that some people use to play the market. Investments at this level can be characterized as price trend bets that have a short holding period. A trade may last for a few days or a couple of years. Investments can include, but are not limited to, common stock, niche mutual funds and ETFs, gold and precious metals, commodity futures and commodity funds. These investments are hit or miss price guessing propositions. Place your bet and hope for the best. All five levels are important to your asset allocation. Some levels you have complete control over, and some you have no control over. You have complete control over the discretionary investments in your personal accounts and some retirement accounts. You have no control over Social Security benefits, employer-defined benefit pension plan investments, and company-restricted stock. This begs the question, will those non-discretionary assets be there during your retirement? Or do you believe that the benefits from Social Security and employer pensions will be cut or perhaps eliminated in the future? Only a portion of these benefits will transfer to a spouse upon your death, and basically none of it goes to your family with the exception of a small amount of Social Security benefits for your children while they are young. If you purchase an annuity with your retirement money, income will go to you and perhaps your spouse, but not to your heirs unless you take a lower payout. All these issues play an important part in your ultimate investment plan, and you will have to consider them in your asset allocation. Stick with core mutual funds and ETFs. Asset allocation, as framed in this book, is mainly about prudently dividing your discretionary liquid investments among broadly diversified stock and bond mutual funds and exchange-traded funds. This strategy will reduce portfolio risk over time, and this leads to higher investment returns. Some people may believe that they can jumpstart their accounts by selecting superior securities or mutual funds within each asset class. This is attempted through self-management or by paying a professional advisor to pick investments. Neither works. Trying to consistently pick investments that are going to beat their benchmarks is like trying to win a marathon wearing muddy boots. There is a lot of drag, and your odds of winning are very low. The high costs associated with attempting to beat the market will almost guarantee sluggish results. In addition to high costs dragging down returns, a vast majority of investors, including professional money managers, do not have the needed information or skill to pick winning securities. By law, all investors must get the same breaking economic and company financial news at the same time. This means that no one has an advantage. Watching CNN, Bloomberg Television, and other financial news networks will yield no useful information that will enable you to earn excess returns over the market. There is a classic saying on Wall Street, "What everyone already knows is not worth knowing." If you happen to become privy to relevant news that others do not have, you cannot use this information to earn extra returns in the market. That is insider trading. Just ask Martha Stewart. She went to jail for trading on inside information she received from the CEO of M-Clone Systems, Inc. You could go to prison even if you receive no monetary benefit from passing someone else inside information. One famous case involved a Wall Street investment banker who passed inside information to a prostitute in exchange for sexual favors. They both went to jail. Even if you or your investment advisor do figure out something that others have not yet realized, you don't know if it's important information or if it's noise. Those people who can tell the difference are few and far between. Charlie Munger, the legendary investor and vice chairman of Berkshire Hathaway, explained to attendees at the 2004 annual shareholders meeting that Warren Buffett, CEO of Berkshire Hathaway, has been successful because he had a natural gift to sift through thousands of pieces of information and pick out the one or two items that had real market-moving relevance. He then said that the typical investor, including most professionals, spend too much time on irrelevant issues and miss the important things. There are many people who claim that the markets are inefficient and that they can gain excess profits. Well, that's what they say. However, it is not true for a vast majority of investors. For the mere mortals among us, the markets might as well be efficient because we are not Warren Buffett, and neither are the advisors we visit. Consequently, we are not going to tap into the excess returns that may be available from time to time in an inefficient market. Hot funds and cold returns. It often appears easy to forecast future market trends because many market gurus claim that they have. But this is more marketing than fact. The gurus talk only about their winners. There is no independent study that confirms skill among the television personalities. In truth, fads are difficult to forecast and more difficult to make money investing in. By the time you recognize something as a fad, the price of the stocks are already sky high. Back in the early 1980s, only a handful of people predicted that home computers would become a household appliance. The name Microsoft could easily have been confused with that of a brand of bathroom tissue. Who would have guessed that Microsoft Corporation would be one of the most successful companies in the 20th century? When Microsoft was filing an initial public offering, Popular Science magazine was predicting that personal aero cars would replace the family automobile by the 21st century. These car-like flying machines would take off and land in your driveway and eliminate all traffic jams. Today, there are no aero cars in driveways, but almost every household has at least one home computer, phone, game, or other electronic device running Microsoft software. Fad investing can be addictive and costly. Many of the same people who suffered in the tech stock bubble and bust from 1996 to 2000 also suffered in the real estate boom and bust from 2003 to 2008. There are other fad traps that occurred recently. Alternative energy themes were the rage in 2008 when the price of oil hit $150 per barrel. Those stock prices collapsed by year-end when oil prices were back under $50. China stocks are all the rage. Unfortunately, a great economic growth story often becomes a stock investor's disaster. Gold is the hot investment as I write this second edition in early 2010. An ounce of gold reached $1,200 recently, and some people believe it will double to $2,400. We shall see. An alternative to picking the right fad at the right time is to hire a smart and informed mutual fund manager to do it for you. Unfortunately, uncovering the next star mutual fund manager is just as difficult as predicting the next fad. Most people select mutual funds based on past performance. They use ratings put out by companies such as Morningstar Inc. in Chicago. Cash flow studies show that a vast majority of new mutual fund contributions flow into funds that have recently received a 5-star Morningstar rating for performance. The belief among investors is that these funds will outperform in the future. That is not likely. Buying the stars is not a reliable way to pick a winning fund. 5-star ratings typically do not persist, especially when a rush of new money comes in and creates an insurmountable challenge to the fund manager to invest it. This typically means changing investment strategy, which is not what earned them the 5-star rating. Many best-performing managers this year will be next year's mediocre managers, or worse. In the active fund business, nothing fails like success, according to John Bogle, the father of index fund investing. Performance chasing is such a huge issue that the Securities and Exchange Commission mandates that every mutual fund advertisement clearly state that past performance is not an indication of future results. Avoiding bad advice. You will undoubtedly come across financial advisors, newsletter writers, website bloggers, and other sources that infer that they have investment skill. This is not possible. Every advisor who claims to have skill cannot be above average. In aggregate, these advisors are the market, and after advisor fees, fund expenses, and trading costs, advisors' clients must perform below the market. It can be no other way. During 1998 congressional testimony concerning the economic crisis caused by the collapse of long-term capital management, Federal Reserve Chairman Alan Greenspan cautioned against buying into any new concept designed to outperform the markets. The following statement was given before the Committee on Banking and Financial Services of the U.S. House of Representatives. This decade is strewn with examples of bright people who thought they had built a better mousetrap that could consistently extract an abnormal return from financial markets. Some succeed for a time. But while there may occasionally be misconfigurations among market prices that allow abnormal returns, they do not persist. Indeed, efforts to take advantage of such misalignments force prices into better alignment and are soon emulated by competitors, further narrowing or eliminating any gaps. No matter how skillful the trading scheme, over the long haul, abnormal returns are sustained only through abnormal exposure to risk. Greenspan's last line is worth repeating. No matter how skillful the trading scheme, over the long haul, abnormal returns are sustained only through abnormal exposure to risk. Superior investment performance requires increased exposure to risk. This means that advisors, bloggers, hedge fund managers, and bank trust officers can't make up their costs and beat the market without exposing a portfolio to considerable risk. Even Warren Buffett took great risk early in his career by making large bets on a few investments that worked out. If he had not placed big bets on a few companies in the 1960s and 1970s, he would not be wealthy today. Is this the way to do it? There are hundreds of thousands of would-be Warren Buffetts who are not so fortunate. Perhaps many of those people did have skill, but they got unlucky and their money ran out before their investments worked out. We will never know who they are. If you admit that you do not have Warren Buffett's skill, then your investment strategy should be different. Don't try to win big with big bets on a few investments. Instead, select an appropriate asset allocation and use low-cost index funds and ETFs to represent the markets you are investing in. Warren Buffett has publicly stated many times that index funds are the best way for most individuals to own common stocks. Believe him. A great but boring solution. Creating a workable asset allocation based on your needs and implementing your plan with low-cost index funds and ETFs provides an easy-to-understand, easy-to-maintain, reliable long-term investment strategy. This approach is also extremely boring and slow. There are no home-run investments to brag about and no exciting trading stories to tell. Plus, you will have to listen to friends, family, and associates boast about how this or that investment made money for them and why your strategy is not relevant in today's market environment. Investment performance is not about what happened last week, last month, or last year. It is about what happens over a lifetime. You will have the best performance in the last word with an asset allocation strategy. Chances are that people will be coming to you for investment advice over the long term. The funny part about those future conversations will be when other people admit that they had no idea what they were doing, and you just smile. Money is not a game. Investing for the rest of your life and the lives of your loved ones is serious business. The asset allocation strategy outlined in this book may not be a glamorous solution, but it does work. Learn the basics. Create a viable investment policy. Implement your plan. Diligently follow the plan and grind out investment gains as they come. With this no-nonsense, business-like portfolio approach, you have the highest probability of reaching your financial long-term goals. Sometimes boring is good. Time changes investment priorities. Your investment policy and portfolio asset allocation will be unique. It will be based on your situation, your needs today and in the future, and your ability to stay the course during adverse market conditions. As your needs change, your allocation will also need adjustment. Monitoring and adjusting is an important part of the process. The limitations of questionnaires. One shortcut to an asset allocation decision is a risk questionnaire that brokers and advisors like to use. Wall Street has tried very hard to commoditize the asset allocation process so that it can push through a lot of people in little time. Risk questionnaires are the byproduct of this push. How you answer the questions will land your portfolio in a pre-selected box of investments. Risk questionnaires may yield some useful information if the questions are worded well, but overall, they are not the answer to the asset allocation question. The questions typically address only one specific area, the maximum risk a person might be able to handle. Even this question cannot possibly be determined by a computer model alone. The questionnaire approach probably works better on young investors who have a lot more in common with one another than people in their 50s and 60s. These more established investors need a lot more attention in order to create a plan that reflects their unique situation. Finding a person's maximum tolerance for risk takes a lot more than a questionnaire. It requires soul searching. We tend to be brave in a bull market, and this means that it is not the ideal time to search for our risk tolerance. Soul searching should be done in a bear market when we are not sure what is going to happen next. Our changing needs. As your financial needs change, your attitude toward investing changes, and accordingly, the asset allocation of your portfolio will need to be adjusted to accommodate changes in your life. The following paragraphs touch on some of those issues and adjustments that occur during life. In this second edition, you will find several passages that cover these topics in more detail. Let's start with young investors and their investment strategy. Young investors should have, at the core, a savings plan. Learning to save is more important than learning to invest at this stage in life. A young person will likely try different investment strategies and lose money on most of them. But this is the time to experiment. Young investors have the luxury of time on their side. Mistakes are not large because these investors have little money in the game and plenty of time to make up losses. A $5,000 loss on a $10,000 investment at age 25 is much easier to overcome than a $500,000 loss on a $1 million investment at age 65. As time passes, youthful dreams are gradually replaced by midlife realities. Careers are progressing, families are forming and growing, and daily life becomes predictable and routine. By midlife, people tend to have a good idea of their career potential and what their long-term earning stream will be like. For the first time, people can envision how they might live in retirement and how they might refine their savings and investment plan to reach that goal. Investors in their late 50s and early 60s are typically in their peak earning years and are starting to actively prepare for some form of retirement. Children are finished with school or close to it, and they hopefully have found jobs and started careers. During this time, people refocus their energy on those aspects of their personal lives that have been neglected while they were raising a family and plan to do what makes them happy. For many folks, this means working less or not at all. By this time, people should have accumulated enough retirement assets to be able to forecast a realistic retirement date, and their asset allocation should be reviewed and perhaps revised so that they can glide smoothly into the next stage of life. Life is not forever. Portfolios tend to change as people enter their senior years. Investment decisions at this point may look beyond the grave. When people realize that they have enough money for the remainder of their life, they may consider investing a portion of the excess according to the needs and ages of their heirs. Ironically, this could mean that a portfolio becomes more aggressive than the one held currently. Asset allocation is at the center of portfolio management in every phase of life. Younger investors will develop asset allocations from a perspective that's different from that of older investors because they are different. But that does not mean that young investors will have a more aggressive allocation than older people. It depends on each person's unique situation. Asset allocation is personal. There is an appropriate allocation for your needs.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.